Hi, Scott. My name is Ed Welch. I live in Minnesota, and I recently had a Bigfoot sighting. I know you're based here in Minneapolis, and I want to talk to you about what I saw. Give me a call in 6 months.
The history that we were all taught growing up is wrong. My name is Scott Wolter, and I'm a forensic geologist. There's a hidden history in this country that nobody knows about. There are pyramids here, chambers, tombs, inscriptions. They're all over this country. We're going to investigate these artifacts and sites, and we're going to get to the truth. Sometimes history isn't what we've been told. Every time I hear about a Bigfoot sighting, the story is the same. A hairy creature skulking around on 2 feet or hiding in the woods. It's what eyewitness videos always seem to show. But no skeleton or bones have ever been discovered, so I'm a hardcore skeptic. But people do believe the creature is real, and sometimes scary. Most people think that as a geologist, I don't bring much to the debate. But I have to think that just like other American mysteries, like what happened to the lost colony of Roanoke, there might be clues carved in rock. Native Americans recorded a lot of things in rock art, and if evidence like that exists, it could suggest the creature is or was real. It might be time I took a look at what could be America's biggest legend. And what better place to start than by meeting a guy who had a rare sighting right here in Minnesota, in my own backyard, so to speak. You know, I get lots of tips from people about Bigfoot. And what's nice about your experience is we're both from Minnesota.
My sighting had so much detail, it was too evidential to ignore.
It really happened.
Yes. About 100 yards in this direction.
Your experience happened right out here?
Yes, it did.
And when was this?
October 9th of 2008. Brush was 8 feet tall. It was hard to get through.
So you're climbing through the woods, you're in the middle of the brush, and what did you see?
What I heard was a loud crack, as if a large branch was being broken.
Mm-hmm.
As I looked towards the area where I heard the crack noise, I seen this being running away from me.
What did it look like?
It had to be around 8 feet tall, and it was grayish white in color.
Okay.
And so I seen this thing moving away, there was no sound. It was like it was floating away from me, and the muscles in the upper back were rippling.
How far away were you?
About 30 yards, 35 yards.
Were you frightened? I mean, how did you feel at this point?
I was later, but I think what happened was I had an adrenaline rush. I started taking off towards it.
So you chased it?
Yes. But then after about 40 yards, I lost track of it. It seemed to just disappear.
Now, obviously, it had a strong impact on you. What happened afterwards?
A severe panic attack hit. Like somebody hit me with a stun gun. I fell to my knees and I looked around. I was severely frightened. Mm-hmm. I felt like my life was in danger.
Well, what happened then? I mean, did you get out of there? Or?
I ran out of the park. I stumbled out onto that road. I fell on my knees and I was just drained. I was in shock. That shock lasted for 3 days.
So when people say they think that you're full of it or you're making this up or you're trying to get attention, what's your response to that?
It is something you have to see. To believe. I don't blame the non-believers. I've seen something that most people never see. I know it exists. This is not a myth or a legend. This is a reality.
And I absolutely believe that you believe you had this experience. I'm not questioning that. And there are a lot of people I've talked to who are absolutely convinced that they had these experiences. But for me, I need more hard, tangible evidence. I need something I can really sink my teeth into.
There's a person I know that lives here in Minnesota. He's a resident Bigfoot research expert. You'll be able to get a lot of information, a lot more tangible things to help you out. His name is Doug Hijack.
Mm-hmm.
Over the last 90 years, there have been more than 3,300 Bigfoot sightings in the U.S. and Canada. But the legend of Bigfoot, or Sasquatch, goes far beyond North America. Almost every country has its own story of a Bigfoot-like beast. The Aborigines of Australia have tales of the Yowie. And in South America, a creature similar to Bigfoot goes by many names, including Mapinguari. And of course, in the Himalayas, stories of a similar creature called a Yeti exist. People have wondered for a long time if the Yeti and Bigfoot might be connected, but so far, no one's been able to prove a link, despite hundreds of eyewitness accounts in both parts of the world. Most of these eyewitness accounts sound like Ed's, and to convince me that Bigfoot exists, I'll need more evidence than a first-hand report of a fleeting sighting. You have obviously invested a lot of time in this and a lot of money.
24 years now.
Those look like petroglyphs. You got a giant skull there. How did you first get into this?
I was way up in the Arctic, in the middle of nowhere. And there on the shore are these massive footprints.
How big were they?
They were about 14 inches at the length. The stride between them was between 40 and 48 inches. There were footprints on both sides of 7 foot tall spruce trees.
Going over one tree, the tops?
Yes. And so it walked over and
this wasn't a polar bear or something like that?
No,
right?
This was very clearly toes, just like big human feet. And they were deep. So I get home and I can't get this out of my mind.
Right.
Something made those tracks.
Sure.
And I started contacting every scientist I could, anybody who would listen to me. I went on literally hundreds of expeditions, tested blood, scat, hair. I probably have conducted more scientific tests on evidence than anybody else.
Clearly, this has been a very personal mission for you to get answers, and it's obvious to me that you're not kidding around.
Absolutely.
Because I have to be honest, when I hear the term Bigfoot, it almost sounds comical.
I like to refer to it as a North American ape.
Okay.
But I think that best describes what it is.
I would like to talk about some of the scientific aspects of this. You must have heard of Gigantopithecus.
Yeah, absolutely. I've got a replica skull right here.
Gigantopithecus, or Giganto, is an extinct ape that lived thousands of years ago in Asia. Evidence of Gigantopithecus was actually discovered by accident. In 1935, Dr. Ralph von Königswald came across a large molar in China. He figured out that it belonged to a type of ape that had never been identified before. Today, this species is known as Gigantopithecus blackie, the largest primate ever to roam the Earth.
This is Giganto. This is the ape that lived in Southeast Asia.
Okay.
The brown areas represent all the fossils that have been found in Southeast Asia.
So the dark areas are actual fossil material that's been collected.
The
white is all reconstructed.
And because of the way the jaw sits and because of the way then that the vertebrae come up into the skull, some scientists believe that this animal probably walked bipedal.
Upright.
Upright, yep.
How old is this thing and how tall was it?
These fossils were dated at about 300,000 years.
Okay.
And this ape was believed to stand at 10 feet tall. So it's quite big. Yeah, it's definitely the real King Kong.
Can I look at that?
It was cast by a sheriff in Grays Harbor, Washington, way back in the 70s. He knew his stuff, and he knew he was looking at a real animal track.
Well, this is clearly not a bear. This is not any animal I've ever seen. It looks like a human foot. You know, we have real bone. We have evidence of a giant ape. Could this be related to Bigfoot?
It absolutely could be related. I mean, it may have crossed the land bridge.
Scientists believe that nearly 12,000 years ago, a land bridge connected Asia with North America. The Bering Strait land bridge allowed humans and animals to roam freely from one continent to the other. This is why some people think the Yeti of the Himalayas and Bigfoot of North America are connected. If a huge ape known as Gigantopithecus blackie or a Yeti was living in Asia at that time, who's to say it didn't migrate over to North America with other species? I wouldn't say that now, but maybe I could be convinced.
Some of the most compelling evidence is the authentic Sasquatch hairs that I've examined.
Hair?
I have some in my possession.
Wait a minute. You're saying you actually have some Bigfoot hair?
The legend of Bigfoot is alive and well in North America, where people hunt Sasquatch every day. But the facts I've heard so far aren't strong enough, and I'm still skeptical. But if someone has hard evidence, like a hair sample, I have to see it.
So wait a minute, Doug. You're telling me you actually have Sasquatch hair here?
Yeah, I do.
Well, that I gotta see.
This, Scott, is a supposed Sasquatch hair. Sasquatch hair has been hard to get DNA out of because of the lack of the medulla.
Okay.
Because that's what holds the majority of the DNA in a hair. If I was to get this analyzed for DNA, it's going to need to go into the hands of somebody that really gets it.
And explain to me what the medulla is.
The medulla is just simply the core in the center of the hair.
Where'd you get it?
This originated from a Forest Service worker in the Blue Mountains of Washington, a kind of an arid area, and there was a spring there, and he was noticing footprints day after day.
Can we take a look with your scope here?
Yep. But if you go ahead and just flick those two switches on. And you can zoom in and out, and you can focus at the very bottom ring.
Well, here we go. Let's back off a little.
And I've checked the scaling from another small sample, and the scaling is primate.
The scaling on hair fibers can serve as a fingerprint in identifying an animal. For example, scaling on a deer hair has a diamond scale pattern, while scaling on a human or a primate is thicker with an irregular wave pattern. Doug believes his hair fiber is similar to that of an ape, and since apes are not indigenous to the Pacific Northwest, Doug believes it's a different creature. He believes it's Bigfoot.
Sasquatch hair has to have a naturally worn tapered end, meaning it was never cut. Since hair grows from the root up, if once the hair is cut, it's always cut.
Okay.
It never can go back to a naturally worn end. You can see it has not been cut. Now, if we were to take one of your hair, I mean, it looks like a knife. It's been cut. It's that sharp, the end of the hair. Yeah, let's do it, and you'll see what I'm talking about on that blunt end.
There we go.
See the cut end?
Yeah.
Zoom in on that.
Well, there it is. Clearly, it's a blunt end. It looks very different than that end of the other hair, the Sasquatch hair. Wow, look at that. So you feel this is legitimate Bigfoot hair?
Yeah, there's tracks to back it up, handprints to back it up, and then, of course, the physical evidence of the hair that was collected right at the spring where these things were coming into drink.
You mentioned something about DNA testing. If you're up for it, I'd be willing to get this tested for DNA.
I'd be really up for it because I think it would have more credibility with an independent person like yourself testing it versus me, who is highly involved.
The hair, the cast, the skull, those are also interesting pieces of evidence that you've put forth. But I have to say, I'm still skeptical. I have to ask you the obvious question. The thing that's burning in my brain is, where is the body? Where is a body? I've never heard of anybody finding a Sasquatch body or even bones. Where are they?
Well, that's when my scientific side kicks in and goes, okay, these things cannot exist because we don't have a bones. But then on the same token, we have, for instance, 40,000 black bears living in Minnesota. Mm-hmm. I've never heard of anybody running into any bones of a black bear.
Well, you know what? Now you have, because I found one.
Okay.
After I graduated from college, I worked as a field geologist. I was walking in the woods and I found the complete skeleton of a black bear and I collected the skull.
Okay, I'm sorry I brought that analogy up.
Of course, right?
Of course. But the point really is they disappear pretty darn quick.
Well, that's true. They won't last long in nature. So unless you find it shortly after the animal was killed or died, there isn't gonna be long and it'll be gone.
Scientists have used video to show how quickly animal remains disappear. This video shows the corpse of a deer. It disappears almost completely in just 7 days.
There is probably 500 words for the name Sasquatch or Bigfoot in native languages. It's very much a part of native culture. And there's one area that you as a geologist I really think should visit, and that's the petroglyphs in California. It's an area that really represent, to me, Bigfoot.
There's a lot more work that I need to do before I'm ready to say that Bigfoot exists. I'm gonna test this DNA. I wanna see what that turns up. And I'm gonna take a look at these petroglyphs.
So far, I'm short on physical evidence that could make me believe Bigfoot exists. But what I do have are consistent eyewitness accounts. In addition to Ed's story, Doug has a friend he's connecting me with who had a sighting right here in Minnesota, and he has video of the creature. For now, I stand by my argument that bones are the missing evidence. I'm intrigued by the Bigfoot petroglyph that Doug mentioned. It's in California, which is prime Bigfoot country. There are more sightings here and in the Pacific Northwest than anywhere in the country. As a geologist, clues in stone sound very promising. And the fact that it's Native American makes me wonder just how old it is.
Kathy.
Yes.
Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you too.
Grab a seat.
Oh, thank you.
I'm interested in learning more about Bigfoot.
It just so happens you're sitting in the heart of Bigfoot country right here. In the four counties that make up this national forest, there are over 55 sightings.
55 sightings?
Yes.
For me, I don't consider it hard evidence, but I was talking to a researcher in Minnesota who talked about some petroglyphs out here. Now, being a geologist, that's something I can literally get my hands on. You must know something about these.
They're actually pictographs, they're not petroglyphs, so they're not carved into the rock, they're painted on.
They're painted on?
They're painted on, so they're difficult to date.
Well, that is different. Unfortunately, I'm not gonna be able to do much with that.
I do have something that I can show you that I think the geologist in you would appreciate.
And what's that?
Would you like to see Bigfoot's bones?
So did you really just ask me if I want to see Bigfoot's bones?
Yes.
You're serious?
Yes.
Well, let's go.
All right. So here are Bigfoot's bones.
Well, this is a natural rock outcropping. How does this connect with Bigfoot's bones?
According to Native American stories, rocks like these symbolize Bigfoot bones.
They do kind of look like bones a little bit, the way they're rounded.
Well, we have a local tribe known as the Miwok, and they have a traditional story. Bigfoot was known for taking children, and he would carry a basket on his back, and that's how he would take the children. The tribe set some pine cones on fire, threw it down into his basket, and he caught on fire. And he asked the people, which way should I fall? And they told him to fall to the north. And so this is where he fell.
This is a mythological story.
Yes.
You know, I've certainly dealt with giants before. You probably heard of the Judicata Stone in Cherokee territory. And their stories talk about a giant who hopped from mountaintop to mountaintop. The giant stories are very pervasive through Native American cultures all across the continent. These stories within the Native tribes about these giants, could there be a connection with Bigfoot?
I feel there's a very strong connection because when you look at the description of what these giants look like, they're hair covered, they're bipedal, they're very large, and the tribes felt they were just another form of people. You know, I brought something with me that I'd like to show you that I think will help seal the deal that these tribal stories are about Bigfoot.
Okay, I'm ready. Let's go.
Here it is.
Well, look at that.
These are known as the Hairy Man pictographs. When you lay this over the pictographs, it gives you a better sense of what you're looking at.
Oh, yes. It sure does. Well, this looks like it could be a depiction of a Bigfoot. And this looks like a smaller one, and then a smaller one yet.
This is the Bigfoot family. So this is Hairy Man, the father, this is the mother, and this is the baby.
This is obviously a replica. How big is the actual pictograph?
Well, Hairy Man himself is 8 feet tall. He was drawn life size. And so the cave itself is probably somewhere around 12 to 10 feet long.
Really?
Yes, this pictograph is part of a traditional story that they have about how man was created. And when man came up out of the earth and he saw Hairy Man, he ran away because he was afraid of Hairy Man. And Hairy Man drew himself with tears because he was sad that they were afraid of him.
How old is this?
We know it's at least 500 years old, but we suspect it may be as old as 1,000 years.
1,000 years. This is long before Hollywood and popular media became obsessed with Bigfoot. So this legend isn't something that the natives came up with because it was cool. Obviously, this is a very important and very old part of their culture and their stories.
Yeah, we actually have photographs and old drawings of it back as late as 1888. So there's no doubt that it existed prior to the modern craze on Bigfoot.
Most of the evidence that I've seen so far, I have to admit, is sketchy at best. But the oral traditions of the native cultures is very compelling to me. So based on those native stories, I know exactly where I'm going next. The evidence I just saw tells me the legend of Bigfoot goes back hundreds, possibly thousands of years. And maybe that means the creature people hunt for was real, or still is. In order to find the truth, I need to look beyond Sasquatch sightings in North America to the place where many believe the creature originated. Says that Bigfoot crossed the land bridge from Asia into North America thousands of years ago. And if that's true, I want to see the evidence. If the Yeti, another legendary ape-like creature that roams the Himalayan mountains, is related to Bigfoot, then the stories, the behavior, and hard evidence like hair and footprints should all match up, or at least be similar. It's taken me 2 long days to get to Nepal, so I hope this trip will be worth it.
You ready to go?
Yeah.
The legend of Bigfoot is strong in the United States. So strong, there are hundreds of people looking for him every day. What if a terrifying creature whose origins date back thousands of years really does exist? I want to know if there's any real evidence out there. If there is, it might just be here in Nepal. I'm headed to a town called Namche Bazar. At an elevation of more than 11,000 feet, this is where Everest climbers stop to acclimate to the thin air. And where stories of the Yeti, Bigfoot's rumored relative, run deep, especially with the Sherpa people.
Excuse me. How much?
Some 500.
500?
Yeah.
I can do that.
Sherpas comprise an ethnic group of people that live at the highest points in the Himalayas. They are highly respected mountain guides and experts in navigating the dangerous terrain. I'm meeting with Sona, a Sherpa and retired guide who led groups around the Himalayas for more than 40 years.
Hi, Sona.
Hi. Nice to meet you.
Have you ever heard of Bigfoot?
I know Bigfoot.
Some people believe that Bigfoot originated over here and migrated across the Bering Strait land bridge into what is now North America. You know, in the United States, the Native Americans have oral stories about Bigfoot. Do the locals here have oral stories going back in time about Yeti?
Around 1963 or for that time, as they have a big problem, the Yeti kills some yaks. Total, the six animals killed. The Yeti is giving hug for the yak. And later on, he throw down, and the yak is already dead.
He squeezed the life out of the yak.
After he throw away,
wow.
And he's really powerful.
Do you think they're still up there?
We have many stories. We can hear some Yeti's noise. This is too low for the Yeti. They live higher than here.
What elevation does the Yeti live at?
So above the timberline, 14,000 feet.
Are there any other large mammals that live up there, like bear or mountain lion, that could explain these attacks?
No, the bear doesn't come this high.
So the only thing that could explain these attacks is a Yeti, right?
Yeah.
Well, Sona, these are great stories, very intriguing, but I have to say, I'm still skeptical.
Yeah, you can talk to some other guy. He saw it, some Yeti.
So you're saying you know somebody who's seen a Yeti?
Yeah. He saw the Yeti.
Yeah?
Yeah, Mingma Dorji.
Mingma, nice to meet you. Tell me about your experience.
Ah, loser. I see to Yeti the loser. And I see to my eyes, and then other people.
I was 14 years old when I saw the Yeti. It had white fur, and its head was pointed. The Yeti didn't see me because I immediately hid from the creature. But then I saw two women walking in the distance, and they didn't see the Yeti. I shouted at the women to look out, that the Yeti was right behind them. They turned around, and they also saw the Yeti. Then they ran away screaming.
Do you think Yeti is still out here somewhere?
Was that keep quiet? Yet you come. Too much people. How can do that? Come to Yeti. keep quiet.
This is a very compelling story. I'm sure you'll never forget it. But I still need to see something more tangible. Is there any remains, a body, a skeleton, hair, scat, anything that we could look at?
Now they have a Kumjung monastery, the one Yeti scalps.
A Yeti scalp?
Yeah, Yeti scalp.
Well, that's amazing. And if that scalp is there, I have to see it. I'm in Nepal trying to figure out how legends of the Yeti connect to legends of Bigfoot in America. People in both places report scary encounters with tall, fur-covered creatures that often hide in the shadows. I want to know, could these creatures be related? And are they even real? Before I left the US, I sent an alleged Bigfoot hair sample from a researcher named Doug Hychek to a lab for DNA analysis. These results may be the key piece of evidence I'm searching for. Now, I'm about to see the scalp of what locals believe to be a Yeti. I want to compare hair on it to the hair I examined at Doug's to see if they look the same.
Hello?
Hello. Namaste.
I'm Scott.
I'm Tenzing.
Nice to meet you, Tenzing.
Thank you.
I understand you have a Yeti scalp.
Yes, we do have a Yeti scalp. Okay, please come.
Where did you get this?
As our history, it says it comes from Tame. Tame is the way to Tibet, but the Yeti scalp itself maybe around 500 years old.
Do you believe in Yeti?
We have to believe, because there was Yeti. So this is Yeti. You are human.
Yeah.
So I have to believe you. You are the human.
Okay.
Okay.
Because I'm here?
Yes.
Is it possible that this could be a different animal, maybe bear or a yak or something else?
This is not a yak, not a bear. This is not a bear area.
Is there any chance that I could take a closer look at this? Could you open the box? There's something specific that I would like to look at on one of the hairs. You've heard of Bigfoot in North America?
Yeah,
yeah. Many people believe that the Yeti is connected to Bigfoot. I talked with a person who had a Bigfoot hair, and the end of the hair was very unique, and it tapers. And I was just wondering if I could take a look at that to see if maybe this matches the other hair that I saw. Well, I'll be very careful.
Yeah, okay.
Okay.
This is not for the Western and not for the other world. This is especially for our culture and the Sherpa people and for the many generations behind.
Sure, I understand.
So you can take it a picture and you cannot touch.
All right, I see one hair right there. I don't even have... Okay. Okay, now we're talking. Okay, let's see here.
See that hair there? It doesn't taper, it breaks off.
Without being able to touch the scalp, it is hard to get a perfect image. But the photos are clear enough that I can see the end of the alleged Yeti hair is blunt, just like the end of a human hair that's been cut. This means the animal that this hair belonged to was domesticated, had its hair trimmed, and was not wild like the Yeti. But who am I to say that the legends these people believe aren't rooted in some element of truth?
So you believe this is a real Yeti scalp?
Yes, I do believe this is a real Yeti scalp.
Okay. I know this is very important and very sacred to you. It's part of the oral stories that your people have. Just like in North America, Native Americans have many oral traditions about Bigfoot.
Yes.
Even though Tenzing believes this is a real Yeti scalp, the evidence I just saw isn't enough to convince me. But it's impossible to deny that the legends run deep here in Nepal and back home in the US. And there's still one last piece of evidence to examine. The DNA results from Doug's alleged Bigfoot hair sample. That could be exactly the hard evidence I'm looking for. Over the years, I've received a lot of tips revolving around the legend of Bigfoot. So far, I've talked to a lot of people who think Bigfoot exists. And when I listen to their stories, I believe that they saw something. But for me, science is the only thing that will prove Bigfoot's real. I sent an alleged Bigfoot hair sample from a researcher named Doug Hychek to a lab in California that specializes in identifying animal DNA. I just got the results back, and I'm on my way to share them with Doug. He also has an eyewitness who claims to have proof that Bigfoot exists right here in Minnesota.
Hey, Doug, this is where your buddy had an encounter, right?
Yep. It's extremely rare to have a daylight sighting.
Well, while we're waiting for him, remember that hair sample that you gave me?
Oh, absolutely.
We sent it in to the University of California. I have the results right here. The sample was received on May 13 of 2014. The DNA was extracted according to standard operating procedures. The resulting sequence was compared with known sequences deposited in GenBank. The DNA obtained from the hairs matched reported sequences for human Homo sapiens. I don't think it's a Bigfoot.
I disagree. These Bigfoot hairs have the tapered end, very little or no mandala.
So you're saying these test results are wrong?
No, I'm saying they're right.
Okay. I'm confused.
I'm saying that every time that I have had a Bigfoot hair tested, they always come back as human.
If you look at the scaling of a human hair and compare it to the hair of, say, a mink, you can see some distinct differences. But if you look at a human hair and a gorilla hair, it's a lot harder to tell the two apart. This is because humans are closely related to primates. Doug believes that Bigfoot DNA shows up as human because Bigfoot could be the missing link between humans and the extinct great apes. In fact, Doug says that Bigfoot is possibly even a closer relative to humans than a gorilla or a chimp.
I would have been let down if it would have came back as some other North American animal, like bear,
right,
for instance.
Right. But for me, this data does not do anything to furthering the question of whether or not Bigfoot exists.
Oh, absolutely.
Well, I'm anxious to hear your friend Joe's story, and is that him?
Yep, that should be him.
Hey, Joe Scott.
Pleasure to meet you.
So, you're the one that saw Bigfoot?
Right in this area.
Tell the story.
As I'm driving through this neighborhood here, all of a sudden I came across auburn-colored biped creature that was in the road, and it was crossing the road.
How big was it?
but I estimated it to be about 8 feet tall. Didn't seem to have like a bob, you know, like a human would bob. I mean, it was fairly fluid, but it was the two steps that I saw and then into the bush it went.
Okay, it was a short sighting.
Yes, exactly. Okay. But very solid. Well, I mean, I have no doubt what I saw.
Okay, but I don't think you're making this thing up. I think you definitely saw something. But, you know, these anecdotal stories, for a hard scientist like me, it's really tough to do much with that.
About 2 weeks after that, on the news, another couple had recorded, using their iPhone, an auburn-colored animal.
Really?
And yes, about 10 miles east of here.
So you guys are convinced it's the same creature?
Well, what I think is his story backs up the video evidence that it's probably legit. So and their video evidence backs up Joe's story.
Do you have that video?
Yes, we do.
I see something moving there, right there.
What's really amazing is the fact it just glides.
Right.
It's really moving.
It's kind of hard to really gauge because I don't know how far away the camera is. Well, that didn't look like any humans I've ever seen, that's for sure.
Well, that's why I've got no doubt what I saw. Mm-hmm. I mean, that I can't erase that memory. That's there.
Yeah. For me to be able to move off of my skeptical opinion, I need to have some hard, tangible evidence. And I've tried my damnedest to find it, and I have not found it yet. The only way that I'm ever going to be convinced that Bigfoot really does exist is when they find a body. I started out this investigation as a skeptic, but with my eyes wide open, searching for the evidence that could change my mind. The legend of a large, ape-like creature that walks on 2 feet runs deeper than I ever imagined. Everyone I talked to throughout my investigation strongly believes the creature is real, and that means something to me. Oral history, handed down, should never be discounted. As for scientific proof, the absence of evidence does not mean Bigfoot isn't real. It just means its existence hasn't been proven yet. But finding a body or a skeleton would prove to me that it's true. Until we do, the mystery of Bigfoot remains just that, a mystery. If you have a mysterious artifact or site I need to see, I want to know about it. Go to history.com/unearthed.